from the various ethnic groups with the men on the green coast. To the same cruel and inhumane treatment to which they too were subjected during slavery in the United States. Consequently, this led to several needless conflicts. Second, in 1847, when Liberia declared its independence from the American Colonization Society, which had played the role of a colonial authority, we had the opportunity for our brothers and sisters who were repatriated from these United States and their kin who they met on the Green Coast to come together and build a united, democratic, and prosperous Liberia. But again, the opportunity was missed. For example, only those from the repatriated stock served as delegates to the Independence Convention. Accordingly, the Constitution and national symbols, such as the flag, the emblem, and the motto, only reflected the cultural and historical experiences of the repatriated stock. The motto reads, for instance, "The love of liberty brought us here," clearly refusing to include the ethnic groups that had previously occupied the area. Further, the members of the various indigenous ethnic groups were denied citizenship in the new country, and this remained so until 1905, when partial citizenship was granted, and 1947, when full citizenship was granted to the members of the various indigenous stocks. Third, in spite of the discriminatory practices the repatriates meted out against their indigenous brothers and sisters, Liberia was nonetheless making considerable progress in terms of the development of local entrepreneurship. This was evidenced by the fact that there were several thriving Liberian-owned businesses in various sectors of the economy. But by 1869, faced with competition from foreign businesses, both the Liberian government and local business people failed to design and implement strategies that would have assisted local businesses to be more competitive. Instead, local entrepreneurship was abandoned, and the government became the major source of employment. Since then, various public officials have used their positions to engage in corrupt practices, such as extortion and the receipt of bribes, as the way of getting rich and without risk. In sum, politics became a life and death struggle in which people did and still do all they can to secure control of the Liberian government. In turn, the faction or fraction that has control of the government at a particular historical juncture uses political power to reap personal economic benefits through the processes of plundering and pillaging the public coffers. In short, the Liberian government has become and is still like a buffet service in which those who control the government and their relations eat all they can eat for free,
yeah,
while the majority of Liberians look, yeah, through their windows with empty stomachs. Fourth, in 1926, the beginning of the opening of the floodgate to foreign investment, Liberia had the opportunity to establish and enforce an investment code that would require, among other things, that foreign-based companies set up plants in Liberia to manufacture goods from the raw materials they were extracting. Unfortunately, this was never done. Hence, the various major foreign-based companies like Firestone, LMC, Bond Mines, and Lanco simply used Liberia as a source for the extraction of raw materials such as latex and iron ore. In fact, in Firestone's extended concession agreement that covers an additional 59 years, there is absolutely no requirement for the company to manufacture tires and other rubber-based products in Liberia. Similarly, under the new wave for foreign investment that began in 2006, Liberia still remains a source only for the extraction of raw materials. Fifth, during the Tubman administration, we spent 27 years, the height of the foreign investment boom, Liberia again had the opportunity to build a democratic and prosperous country. Well, unfortunately, this era was marked by the violation of political human rights and the failure to make meaningful investments in education, healthcare, and infrastructure, among other things. This led Robert Clora and others to characterize the socioeconomic situation of this period as growth without development. Six, the emergence of the Togo era was greeted with great joy by the majority of Liberians, and the administration fueled these hopes by among other things, opening up the political space so that Liberians could exercise their constitutionally guaranteed political rights and civil liberties, and by undertaking various development projects, including public housing and the infrastructure. However, the wind of change was quickly battled by the agents of the same old, same old. Seventh, the April 12, 1980 military coup was welcomed with amazing joy by the majority of Liberians. The hope was that Master Sergeant Samuel Doe and his fellow members of the ruling People's Redemption Council, who hailed from the lower class, would have brought about sweeping changes in all of the sectors of the country. Unfortunately, by the very poor performance of the military government, the coup was nothing but a promise betrayed. Similarly, the Doe civilian government, which lasted from 1986 to 1990, performed even worse than the military regime. And this was reflected in, for example, politically motivated killings of real and imagined political opponents of the regime, the violation of political rights and civil liberties, rampant corruption, and very limited socioeconomic progress. Eighth, the cycle of missed opportunities led to the French Civil War from 1989 to 1997. After the death of more than 250,000 people, the injuring of thousands of others, mass population displacements as refugees and internally displaced persons, and the destruction of an already underdeveloped infrastructure, the war finally ended thanks to the leadership of the Economic Community of West African States. Subsequently, Charles Taylor, whose National Patriotic Front of Liberia started the war, was overwhelmingly elected president of Liberia for several understandable reasons, including the fear by the majority of the voters that a Taylor laws would have meant the return to war. During its tenure from 1997 to 2003, the Taylor regime failed to fulfill its vaunted promise of making Liberia the Hong Kong of Africa. This was reflected in the fact that mass abject poverty was widespread, there was a lack of functioning public hospitals and schools, and the infrastructure which had been destroyed by the war remained in ruins. To make matters worse, that the Doe regime, the Taylor one, engaged in politically motivated killings of both its real and imagined opponents, as well as the wholesale violation of political rights and civil liberties. In addition, corruption continued to be a national sport, as evidenced by the continuation of the practice of using the public's money as an ATM machine from which government officials withdrew cash anytime they wanted to do so. Ninth, the similarly unending cycle of missed opportunities, including the poor performance of the Taylor regime, resulted in the country's second civil war from 1999 to 2003. Characteristically, the war visited deaths, injuries, displacement, and destruction on our country. Again, under the leadership of ECOWAS, efforts were made to terminate the war. After a two-year transitional period, presidential and legislative elections were held in 2005, and Mrs. Ellen Johnson Sirleaf was elected the president of Liberia. President Sirleaf's election was greeted with a wave of optimism and hope by the majority of Liberians. Also, the international community provided assistance of various types in an unprecedented manner. In short, the Sirleaf regime came into office with a lot of goodwill from both Liberians and the international community. After more than 8.5 years in office, the evidence shows that the regime has made appreciable progress in improving the respect for political rights and civil liberties. However, on the social and economic front, the regime's performance has been very poor. After leasing about 33% of the country's land to various foreign investors, including major concessions to Sam Darby, a Malaysian-based multinational corporation, which was given 220,000 acres of land for a 63-year lease to invest in the palm oil sector, and Golden Valorum, an American and Indonesian oil palm multinational, which was given 865,000 acres of land under a lease agreement for 65 years, and an overall foreign investment totaling about $19 billion. The material conditions of the majority of Liberians have not improved. For example, according to the Salivary James Old Ministry of Labor, in 2010, the unemployment rate stood at an alarming 95%. Similarly, during the same period, more than 56% of the population lived below the poverty line. Significantly, these dire economic and social conditions have made living on a daily basis a major challenge, as most Liberians lack the financial means to purchase food and the other basic essentials of life. Unfortunately, these challenges have led some of our fellow citizens to commit suicide because they have given up hope. To add salt to injury, political corruption has increased and become widespread as various public officials use an assortment of corrupt means, including the receipt of bribes, extortion, and outright stealing of public funds to enrich themselves. Overall, the dominant mindset is that Liberia is doomed. In addition, the cycle of missed opportunities in our country's history has not only been caused by anti-people and anti-development regimes, but by Liberians themselves. Indeed, former Vice President Benny Warner's poignant declaration, "What is wrong with us is us," which was made about four decades ago, still has relevance in Liberia today. And the meaning of this declaration is reflected in several ways. One, we encourage political corruption by expecting public officials to dole out money from the public coffers to individuals and groups for private purposes that have absolutely nothing to do with the provision of public service. In addition, we regularly ask public officials to give us gas slips and to allow us to use government vehicles and equipment for private purposes. Two, we do not like to follow a system that is based on rules and processes. Instead, we let the corrupt Liberian way of shortcut illegal transactions. Three, we are instantly impressed by form, including the names of so-called important political families. Four, our discourse is very uncivil. For example, the discourses on several of the Liberian-related discussion forums are characterized by personal attacks, personal insults, and the desire for personal destruction. In other words, no attention is given to focusing the discussions and the resulting disagreements on the differences on policy issues. In fact, these uncivil discourses have been visited on President Sirleaf. For example, President Sirleaf has been the victim of personal attacks and personal insults on several of these discussion groups, as well as on radio and in the newspapers at home in Liberia. Now, don't get me wrong. It is a healthy thing to respectfully disagree with the policies of the Sirleaf regime. But it is completely unacceptable to subject the president of Liberia, a mother and a woman, to personal attacks and personal insults. My fellow Liberians, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, clearly these 167 years of independence have been marked by missed opportunities and their resulting hardships on the majority of Liberians. And as a result, our people have lost hope. And they also believe that our dear country is doomed. But by the grace of the Almighty God, who makes the impossible possible, I have come to boldly declare tonight that Liberia is not doomed. In fact, the best of Liberia is yet to come.
Amen.
I see emerging on the broad Atlantic coast a new Liberia, in which the cycle of missed opportunities will finally be broken.
Amen.
You and I, we're seeing in our lifetime a new Liberia, in which the descendants of the Coopers, the Dennises, the DeShields, the Talbots, the Tubmans, among others, will work together with the descendants of the Dons, the Formulas, the Yankuns, the Yakamos, among others, in the true spirit of unity. In Liberia, in which, to quote Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., one will be judged on the basis of the contents of their character. In so doing, our national symbols, emblem, motto, and flag will reflect the various cultural and historical experiences of all of our people. In the new Liberia, public service will be a noble undertaking, rather than a quest to get wealth through corrupt means. In this vein, public officials will make the interests of the Liberian people the focus of their respective responsibilities. In the new Liberia, the political rights and civil liberties of all Liberians will be protected. In this vein, for example, Liberians will hold their public officials accountable and will broadly require integrity and honesty from their government. In the new Liberia, we will make massive public investments in world-class education and research, healthcare, public transportation, public housing and infrastructure, including full access to clean drinking water, sanitation, and electricity. The resulting benefits will impact every county, every district, every city, every town, every chiefdom, every clan, and every village. In the new Liberia, we will create employment opportunities by the government creating an enabling environment in which Liberian-owned businesses can thrive and succeed. In addition, foreign investors will be required to create employment opportunities for Liberians both within their companies and by helping to spur the development of Liberian-owned businesses by their manufacturing activities. By so doing, the thousands of Liberians, including scores of our young people who are unemployed, will be able to find jobs so that they can live decent lives. In the new Liberia, we will give special attention to our young girls and women who have become prostitutes because of the hardship of life. Also, we will show concern for our elderly and the mentally challenged, as well as for all other vulnerable groups. In the new Liberia, we have a new political culture that is characterized by civility in our discourse. In this vein, we will focus the discourse and the resulting debates and disagreements on policies and not personalities. As well, we will respect government officials for the positions that they hold and as fellow human beings. In the new Liberia, we will protect our environment from destruction by the pollution of the air, land, and water. We'll do so by designing and strictly enforcing environmental regulations. Finally, my fellow Liberians and distinguished ladies and gentlemen, when we have constructed a new democratic and prosperous Liberia for all of our people, then all of us, Liberia's sons and daughters, Christians, Muslims, the adherents of traditional religions and others, the descendants of the various indigenous ethnic groups, of the repatriates, of immigrants from other African states, and of immigrants from the Caribbean, men and women, old and young, will form a gigantic human chain from the picturesque Batawi Falls in Bong County, to the scenic Blue Lake of Bami, from the tree-rich Bella Falls in Bapolu, to the beautiful Atlantic coastline in Buchanan and Grand Bassa County, from the tourist haven of Lake Piso in Grand Kidd Mount, to the Putu and Temple Mountain ranges in Grand Gia County, from the wonders of River Numa in Grand Cru County, to the agricultural richness of Foya in Lofa County, from the multiple economic benefits of a revised Firestone concession agreement in Mangibi County, to the economic engine of the Port of Harcourt in Maryland County, from the welcoming view of Providence Island in Montserrat County, to the reassuring outlook of Saclepi in Nima County, from the shipbuilding potentials of Sester City in Riverside County, yes. To the highlands of the Kidepo Range in River G County, and to the valleys of Kidepo in Sano County, and in true celebration of our independence, we will sing with real meaning and purpose, with hearts and hands, our country's cause depending. We meet the foe with valor of pretending. Long live Liberia, happy land, in whom a glorious liberty by God's command.
Hallelujah.
May the sovereign God, who is able to keep us from falling, take us, guide us, and lead us on this national journey to break the cycle of missed opportunities. May the God of mercy and renewal rebuild our country and watch over our counties, our districts, our cities, our towns, our chiefdoms, our clans, and our villages. May God, who is the source of both physical and spiritual strength, enable us to run and not be weary, to walk and not faint. May God enable us to invest in our children, bring joy and happiness to all Liberians, give our country peace and stability, prosper the works of our hands, and save our dear old Liberia. God bless you. Happy 20th.